And in your Bibles, you can turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, a passage of Scripture you're probably very familiar with. And we're going to look at the first eight verses of that today. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 1 through 8. Paul says, "If I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but do not have love, I've become a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and know all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. And if I give away all my possessions to charity, and if I surrender my body so that to be burned, but do not have love, it does me no good. Love is patient. Love is kind. It is not jealous. Love does not brag. It is not arrogant. It does not act disgracefully. It does not seek its own benefit. It is not easily provoked, does not keep an account of wrong suffered. It does not rejoice in unrighteousness, but rejoices with the truth. It keeps every confidence. It believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails." So we've been talking this last couple of weeks about being an influencer, that we can be an influencer for God. In our life, we have an influence, and we have to choose what our platform is going to be, what message we want to spread in our lives, what's important to us. And I hope for all of us that God is important for us, that He is the one that we follow, He's the one that we obey, and that we want to be able to help others to be able to follow God as well, so that we can be salt and light in this world around us. And that's how we become a godly influence. And we've been looking at we've been looking at ourselves and to make sure that we've made those good decisions for ourselves, and we've made that commitment within our life to live this type of life that honors God, glorifies Him, and can be a witness to those around us. And one of the ways that we can be an influencer is by being an advocate. Now, we don't maybe use this word very much, but I want to talk about this today. Because an advocate is one who pleads the cause of another. And other words to describe an advocate is a friend, a supporter, and a defender. In fact, we find in Scripture that Jesus is our advocate. It's in 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2, verse 1. We can go ahead and bring that up, I think. 1 John chapter 2, verse 1. "My little children, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. And if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous." So Jesus is our advocate. He speaks to our Heavenly Father in our defense. Now, the Bible shows us in this passage of Scripture that as Christians, we are taught in Scripture not to sin. We're given the tools and the powers so that we don't have to sin, but we know that we struggle. We know that we stumble and that we do sin. And when we do sin, we have an advocate that speaks for us, that defends us. He stands, Jesus, He stands before the Father to defend us based on His sacrifice for us. Not that we're a good person or God should give us a break, but no, He has sacrificed His life. He shed His blood for us, and therefore He defends us with that statement. He's our mediator. He's our advocate. He's the one who pleads for us and speaks on our behalf. And through that, He declares us not guilty. And so we're able to move through that problem, to repent of that sin, and to continue on as we follow God. And that sin doesn't derail us and keep us from following God. And so that's what Jesus has done for us. And as an influencer for God, I mean, that's what we're called to do in this life, to be a witness, to be able to influence others. We have the opportunity to be an advocate for one another, to be that friend and that supporter and that defender and that one who helps each other to be able to stand firm in our faith and to follow the Lord together. Now, there's another example of an advocate in the Old Testament. It's Abraham. Abraham sought to defend and to protect Lot. It happened in Genesis chapter 18. So in Genesis chapter 18, we read that the Lord appeared to Abraham. Now, what Abraham sees are three men. Three men come to visit him. Now he offers them water to wash their feet. He offers them a meal. Abraham is a good host to these men that come. Now in the conversation that goes on between Abraham and these three men, the Bible keeps saying that the Lord spoke to Abraham. So God is using this situation to speak to Abraham. And in this conversation, the city of Sodom comes up where Lot lived. And Abraham found out that the Lord was going to judge the city of Sodom and destroy it because of their sin. And so Abraham then asked the Lord, asked through these three men, if the Lord would judge Sodom if there were 50 righteous people found in the city. And the response from God was, no, if there's 50 righteous people in the city, I won't judge the city of Sodom. And then Abraham started to just bring this number down with him. He says, well, what about 45? If there are 45 righteous people in the city, will you still destroy the city? Nope, won't destroy it. How about 40? If there are 40 righteous people, nope, won't destroy it. How about 30? How about 20? How about 10? And that's where Abraham stops. And the Lord said, if there are 10 righteous people in the city of Sodom, then I will not destroy that city. Now, Abraham was not just pleading for the city of Sodom. He was pleading for his nephew Lot. Lot lived there. And he didn't want Lot destroyed with this whole city when God came in and brought his judgment upon them. And so he was hoping that there would be enough righteous people in that city that Lot would be spared and God would not destroy Sodom. There weren't 10 righteous people in that city. God was still going to go down and destroy it. But for Abraham's sake, he took Lot and his family out of that city. And we know the story. And even Lot is not very righteous. Now, Peter does call him a righteous man in the midst of all these sinners, but his lifestyle isn't showing that righteousness at this particular point. But God, probably for Abraham's sake, is the one who sends the messenger, sends the angels in to take Lot and his family out of that city before it was destroyed. Why was he spared? Probably because of Abraham. Because Abraham spoke on his behalf. He chose to be his advocate, defending him and pleading for him. And again, Lot didn't even use that situation to make good decisions after that. But we're thinking about Abraham and what Abraham did to be an advocate for Lot. So why is Jesus our advocate? And why did Abraham choose to be Lot's advocate in that situation? Well, it's very simple. It's one word, love. Because Jesus loves us, he defends us, he speaks for us. Because Abraham loved Lot, he was willing to speak for Lot and for the city of Sodom to somehow stop the judgment of God from coming upon them. So love was the motivation. And if we are going to be an effective influencer, a person who is salt and light in this world, doing the will of God and influencing others to do the will of God, then we need to be motivated by this idea of love. We need to be motivated by biblical love, the love that we read about in Scripture. Now, normally when we think of being an advocate, you've probably heard more of it like in a medical community. Somebody is in a situation in a hospital or in a nursing home, and they can't really defend themselves. They can't speak up for themselves. And so somebody else comes in, a relative or a friend, and is the one who's getting the doctor's attention and the administrator's attention to just to make sure that this person that they love is getting the very best care in that situation. And that's why I think this idea of love, which is what's behind all of that, is so important, and it's so well described in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. In fact, that's what we call 1 Corinthians 13, the love chapter, because of the focus on love. And we learn some lessons about love, and we learn some lessons about influence. We learn some lessons about honoring God here in this passage of Scripture in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. And so 1 Corinthians 13 shows us how to honor God, serve Him, help others, be a defender, be that supporter, be that friend, be that one who brings that Christian influence in this world around us. And so as we think about it, why should you care about being an advocate for others? So why would that even be a deal or a big deal in your life? Because God calls us to do this. He calls us to have this influence. He calls us to use our life to help others in this life to follow Christ. Not just help people, but help people follow Christ and learn what it means to live for God, to have that godly influence with the people that surround us, to be salt and light that Jesus talks about. So to be a godly advocate, supporting and helping and being that friend that sticks closer than a brother, as we do that, then we present this godly influence in the lives of others. So let's learn from 1 Corinthians chapter 13 today of how we can be this advocate for others in our life. So first of all, to be an advocate for one another, I must make love a priority. I must make love a priority. In my Christian life, as I follow God, whatever I'm doing, I need to make sure that I'm doing it for the very simple reason I love God with my heart, soul, mind, and strength, and I love my neighbor as myself. That's the reason that I'm doing the things that I do. Again, look at how chapter 13 begins. If I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but do not have love, I become a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and know all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. And if I give all my possessions to feed the poor, and if I surrender my body to be burned, but do not have love, it profits me nothing. Now notice what Paul does here. He takes things in the Christian faith, things that we do, and probably things that we would look at and say, well, that's a spiritual person. That's a person who loves God. That's a person who's doing God's will. And they to do all these things that he's talking about here in these first few verses. But then Paul says, if you do all these things and you're not loving God and you're not loving others, then it's empty. It's not honoring God. God's not pleased by it. And so it doesn't mean just trying to look spiritual in life. We need to make sure we have the right motivation in our life as we seek to do God's will. So looking at this, you know, specifically, he says speaking in tongues. Now, that was a big deal in the church in Corinth. In fact, it seemed like it came to the point, if you read the chapter before and the chapters after, that the church was professing this as the greatest of the spiritual gifts, and that a person needed this gift. And there's been different thoughts about that even today. Now, they were really into spiritual gifts, and that's why they're brought up so much, and that's a good thing. But the problem is they let these spiritual gifts cause pride in their life and division in the church. And that's why Paul has to address this. He's not just writing this letter and say, well, what can I talk about with the church? No, he's had some interaction with the church, and he knows that these are the problems in the church, and so he's addressing the problems. Yes, you say spiritual gifts are important, and they are, but you're abusing them. You're using them for your own glory instead of for the glory of God and for the benefit of the people. And so right away he says, you can have this, what you would call the greatest of the gifts, but if you're not loving one another, you're just making a bunch of noise. And he goes on in verse 2, do you have the gift of prophecy and the word of knowledge and wisdom? Do you have the gift of great faith? And again, he says, as we think about these gifts, I don't know if these gifts impress you when you think about them, but they impress that church in Corinth. In fact, the very next chapter, Paul's going to say about the gift of prophecy of how important that gift really is. And he's going to say all these good things about it. So there's nothing bad about all this. It's just that they, as they were using these gifts, looking like a very spiritual person, doing God's will, Paul says, but you're not. You're not doing God's will. Even if you are showing these gifts in your life and are leaders in the church and are teaching and leading people and directing, and God is using you in those ways, you're not living that life that honors God. You're not living a life that pleases God if you don't love, if you're not loving God, and if you're not loving one another. And so these spiritual gifts without love, they don't impress God. We might get impressed by them, but God's not impressed because He knows our heart. Well, what about that person who helps others? Now, we think of that person as very spiritual, dedicated person, a person who's willing to help others in their life. Paul says, even if you go to the lengths of selling all your possessions to help people in need around you, but if you don't do it from love, it does no good, he said. What he's saying is God's not pleased by it. God's not honored by that. That's not how God wants us to live and be involved in ministry. He wants us to make sure that we start with the basic understanding of I love God first and I love others. And as a result of that, then I'm able to use these gifts and abilities and opportunities and willingness to give of myself. Then I can use that to help others. And to show you how important love is, Paul gives an unbelievable example. What if you become a martyr for Christ, actually dying for Christ? Now, you know, we would normally think, well, that just puts you right in the front of the line to go to heaven, right? If you're willing to die to follow Christ. But Paul says, without love, there's no profit in it. There's nothing good for God in all of that. God is not honored. God is not pleased by that. So he's saying love must be our motivation. So as we follow Christ, we need to make love our priority. Loving God, loving others, as we look at the commands that Jesus reminds us of in the New Testament. And then Paul goes on to describe what this love looks like as he makes this point. Loving God and loving people have to be your motivation in life as you seek to serve God, as you seek to follow God, as you seek to do His will in your life. If you want to be an advocate and help others, if you want to be this influence, salt and light, we need to back up and make sure that we understand that love is that motivation. And that's how we can have that godly influence in a way that God is pleased in all of this. So that's one thought. I must make love a priority. Secondly, my love must build others up. Sometimes we use the word love, but it's not defined the way God defines it in the ways that we use the word sometimes. And then sometimes we use the word love, but there's no action with it. And that's not the way love works, because love, there, as we see love in Scripture, an action must come from that. A positive, good, building others up action comes from this word love when we use it. So that's what Paul does here. When he's describing love, he's describing actions in our lives of how we can show this love to others. Patient, kind, not jealous, not bragging, not arrogant. To act in an honorable way towards others. Not self-seeking, not provoked. You know, to be provoked is to respond in exasperation and irritation. Are you easily irritated in life when people don't do exactly what you want them to do? That's a problem I have. You know, I can have that quick response of, I'm irritated, I'm exasperated. And all that does is tear people down. It doesn't build people up. Love doesn't keep track of faults and mistakes. Therefore, love is forgiving. We can look at this description of love that we see here in 1 Corinthians 13, and we can evaluate how we respond to people around us, how we respond to people in the church, how we respond to people at work, how we respond to people in our family, our friends. How do I respond? Am I showing these traits of love? And to be an advocate to those around us, to be a support, to be a friend, to build people up, we have to understand that this is the action that God wants us to show, to have that godly influence. And so I must make love a priority, and my love must build others up. I can't use this word love and focus on myself. When I think of love, as Scripture teaches it here, my love must build up others around me. And thirdly this morning, my love must honor God. Because again, we can say, in the name of love, I'm going to do this or allow that or be involved in something else. But we have to back up and make sure that in the name of love, that we are honoring God in the things that we say and do and believe. So Paul continues to describe love in this passage of Scripture and basically points out that love does the right thing. Love does the right thing. Not the easy thing, not what everybody wants, but love will do the right thing. Love doesn't rejoice in unrighteousness. Love rejoices in the truth. And then he talks about bearing and believing and hoping and enduring. I think that's all about the truth and this righteousness of God. That's why we love God first. What's the first commandment? What's the greatest commandment? To love God. The second is like it, to love your neighbor as yourself. But it starts with loving God. And when you love God, you're going to love righteousness. When you love God, you're going to love truth. When you love God, you're going to love holiness and purity. You're going to love the things of God that the Bible teaches. Because if you start loving all these other things, then you might have to take a look and ask if you really love God first. When we love God first, we will love His righteousness and we will love His truth. And that will direct our love for one another. If we say, I love God, but we're disobeying God, then we're not loving God. And we just have to, as I mentioned earlier, we just have to examine our heart. And if we live that way, we're not going to be an advocate for the Lord. We're not going to be an advocate and help others follow God. We're not going to be that salt and light if we're not loving God and loving the things that God loves. And this world is subtle. It's subtle. Our society wants to suck us in so that we live just like this society around us. But we're called to live for God. We're called to live in a way that honors Him. In everything that you do, ask if God is honored. Is it the righteous thing to do? Is this in line with God's truth? Those are the questions that we need to ask. I was listening to an interview with a football coach. And he was talking about using sports as a way to influence, young men as they're growing up through high school and college and even maybe even into the pros. But he wants to not just help them be, good athletes. He wants, in this conversation, he talked about his goal was to help them to make good life decisions. Not just good football decisions, but to make good life decisions, to grow up and become mature. And as he was talking about this process, he made a statement that I thought was really interesting. And it was something like this, probably not word for word, but it was something like this, that as he's trying to influence these young men who are playing sports, he'd use this little phrase. Are you a mission completer or a comfort seeker? And just think about that for a bit as we think about following Christ. Are you a mission completer or a comfort seeker? Because, as I think about our life in Christ, that should be my goal. We talked about it last week, that God has a purpose for each one of us, and it's an eternal purpose. And if you look at some of the letters, especially 1 Thessalonians, Paul will write about how he looks forward to seeing the fruit of his labor when he gets to heaven, talking about the people that he brought to Christ. And because he understood that he had this eternal purpose. And God has given us an eternal purpose. We looked at it last week. You can take all the things that you do that you're a part of in this world, and you can make sure Christ is in that, and you turn that into an eternal part of the eternal purpose of God in your life, and you'll see eternal fruit from that. And as we think about being a mission completer, then my life in Christ should be, Lord, what do you want me to do? How do you want me to live? Who do you want me to influence? What ways can I bring honor to you? How can I fulfill your purpose in my life? And that should be a constant thought in our lives daily as we follow God. But instead of being a mission completer, we want to be a comfort seeker. And what that means is, as I look at it, in our relationship with God, we have a different agenda. the agenda is, God, what are you going to do for me? You're going to save me. Okay, good. What else are you going to do for me? You're going to take, I expect, God, that you're going to take away the problems in my life. You're going to take away the burdens in my life. You're going to take away the battles in my life. And I've talked about this before, and I call them comfort prayers. So when you're in a place of discomfort, you can take that place of discomfort and say, okay, Lord, what do I need to learn through this process? Lord, how can I be a better Christian now? How can I follow you more closely as a result of what I'm going through? How can I become more mature in Christ? We could take it that way, but we don't usually, because usually we say, Lord, can you get rid of this for me? That's our comfort prayer. Lord, I don't like this battle. I don't like this burden. I don't like this inconvenience. And our prayers, Lord, you need to get rid of it. You need to take care of it. And so instead of becoming a mission completer, Lord, I want to fulfill your purpose in my life, we become comfort seekers, just saying, God, what are you going to do for me today? How are you going to take care of me tomorrow? I want you to make my life easier instead of more difficult. And then we don't grow. And so I want to encourage you as you think about, yeah, I can be an advocate. I can be an influencer of others. It's going to happen if you choose to fulfill the purpose of God in your life. And that purpose is to be an eternal purpose, to be salt and light in this world, to help others to follow Christ, to help Christians stand firm, to help non-Christians see the truth so that we can be an advocate, helping others, supporting others, influencing others by loving God and loving people. Let's pray. Father, again, thank you for your word, and thank you for this passage of scripture in 1 Corinthians 13. And I pray, Lord, that you will help each one of us to be able to take this and apply this in our lives and to see how we can show love in a way that honors you. And I pray, Father, that you continue to lead us and guide us, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. As we have our invitation song this morning, this is our opportunity to make sure that we are following the Lord and doing His will, trusting in Him. If you need to make a decision for Christ, we're here for you today. You can come forward and talk to us. If you need to have a prayer request and you'd like us to pray with you, feel free to come forward and we'll pray for you as well. Let's stand together.